Global Trust for reporting on the national and global environment. Additional supporters include the Public Welfare Foundation and the Tree Free Company. All Tree Free tissue and towel products are made from 100% recycled fiber.
This is NPR.
This evening, this is meeting number 4 of the 1992-93 fiscal year. Could we have the roll call, please?
Chairman McLaughlin?
Here.
Council Chapel?
Here.
Council Cogsall?
Here.
Council Creelman?
Here.
Council Dahlbeck?
Here.
Council Jordan?
Here.
And Council Pearson.
Would you please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have the minutes of meeting number 3, held July 13, 1992. Could I have a motion on those, please?
Move acceptance, Madam Chair.
Second.
All those in favor? 6-0. Thank you. Next item is citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there anybody who would like to address the council and the gathering this evening for something that is not on the agenda? Okay, seeing none, we will move on to reports and correspondence.
Madam Chairman.
Council Chapel.
The Regional Waste Services had their annual meeting on the 16th of July, and at that time we had a good attendance from Cape Elizabeth. Our town manager was there. Lester Jordan was there, who was one of the original board members, myself, and our chairman. I was nominated for another term as Finance Committee. I appreciated that. At the end of the meeting, they always have a little gift for us. I guess they think we, you know, being member communities and on a no-pay basis, it makes a good board of directors for them. So there's always some little gift. And this year, they gave T-shirts. And I got one to show everybody. And Reggie is the new mascot of the Regional Waste Services. And I went down to the table and I tried to find an extra large, but I couldn't find it, so I had to do with this large as a present to the chairman of the council.
do we call him Reggie?
Thank you.
Now known as Reggie.
Nice color.
Thank you, Councilor Chapel. Did you have anything else, Councilor Chapel, you wanted to share with the gathering?
No, not until next month, though.
Okay. I don't know how we can top that. Anybody else?
Yeah, I just like that. Councilor Chapel, do you need that extra large for yourself or for the chairman of the council?
No comment.
We have comments that we can't make them publicly. Anybody else? Okay. I would like to announce that one of our own, Councilor Wayne Creelman, was recently re-elected to serve on the Cumberland County Budget Advisory Committee, and appreciate his taking the time to do that, and hopefully that committee will have more influence in the coming years on the budget for that group.
Well, thank you very much. It's been an enjoyable last 2 years, and obviously with the new jail coming in Cumberland County, there's going to be a change in the rate there, so we'll do our very best to make it as fiscally conservative as possible for the town.
Very good. Want to make mention of the recent death of Everett Boynton. He had served as town treasurer from 1946 to 1973, a period of 27 years, which I believe is not going to be surpassed in the near future. And that's when the town treasurer was an elected position. I did not know Mr. Boynton, but I know from his obituary it said that's when Cape Elizabeth was all Republican and he managed to get reelected every time because of the good Republican support, which I know some of my fellow councilors can really appreciate here. And another item that those on the council will appreciate, I'm sure, and especially those who worked on the council's ordinance committee and our town planner, who worked very hard on the town's shoreland zoning ordinance. And we have received notification from the state that DEP has approved our shoreland zoning ordinance. And I do thank everybody who worked so diligently to get that into the form that we sent to the state. That's a nice accomplishment for everybody. And even though we still know we have some more work to do on that. And now, we have one very special, item next on the agenda. Jim Murray, would you join me, please?
I can read down it over there.
They have lights here. For those of you who don't know this gentleman, this is Jimmy Murray. He was our acting fire chief since last November 1st, I believe. That's when you officially took over that position. You had helped out in that position for a number of months before that becoming official. I talked to Jimmy today and said, is there anything you want me to mention tonight that I might not normally come up with? Well, I'll tell you. We decided we would tell you what an example he is to anybody who really wants to make their way, working their way up from the bottom. He described himself to me as quite a hellion in his youth. Those were the words I could use, right? Started out in the lowest ranks in the fire department, worked his way up. He's been a deputy for about 8 years now, and as I said, served as our acting chief. While in that position, he had a kind of dubious distinction of, what was it, first or second week you were in that position, we had more fires than we'd had in the previous 2 months. I don't know if that was some kind of...
2 years.
Was that it? Some kind of test that you served very well in. Not only did you serve the day-to-day functions, which maybe were a bit more than you had anticipated. I don't know. That sometimes happens when you go from being a deputy to being in the top position. But you helped lead the department in its deliberations about the ladder truck, which we hope will be gracing our fine town in not too distant future. You were very instrumental in helping with the department's needs assessment. And we thank you for that kind of leadership. It wasn't just going and doing all the routine stuff. You showed a real valuable display of leadership, and I don't think everybody always knows that about you, and it's something we really value. You did a great job, and in recognition of that, we have a lovely, and this says, Town of Cape Elizabeth, an appreciation to Leland P. Jim Murray, Jr., Acting Fire Chief, 1991 to 1992.
Thank you, Janet.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Want to say a few?
Yeah, if I can do it. I want to thank everybody that supported me, my wife and my family in the back. The members of the fire department were tremendous, pulling together. Department heads, Bob Malley and Maureen O'Mara, Dave Pickering, all tremendous support. And boy, without them, you've got nothing. So, great bunch of people, and I also want to thank the town manager for his support, and he's one of the only town managers that will answer the telephone when it rings if somebody's not there to answer it. So, again, thank you very much. I enjoyed it, and it was an honor. Thank you.
Thank you. I look forward to working with the new chief.
We will have our first public hearing of the evening, and this is preceding our item 37, which is to consider the comments from that hearing on proposed traffic lights. We're considering proposed traffic signals at two separate intersections on Route 77, one being the intersection of 77 and Spurwink, the other being the intersection closer to Town Hall here of 77 with Scott Dyer Road and Shore Road. Mr. McGovern?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. This issue has been debated for some time. I thought it might be helpful before the public hearing began, if two individuals updated the town council as well as the members of the public present on the issue, particularly Maureen O'Meara, who is the town planner, who will look at some of the growth implications and some of the issues the planning board has looked at when considering growth in the region, in the community, and whether or not the traffic lights may be necessary. Second is Bill Gray, who is a consulting traffic engineer working with the town. Bill is the city of Portland's full-time traffic engineer, and I think for anyone who drives through Portland and sees how easy it is now to get up and down High and State Street compared to how difficult it used to be in past years, can appreciate the knowledge that Bill applies to traffic principles. I think it's safe to say that he's probably the best full-time municipal traffic engineer in the state. I think he's probably also the only full-time municipal traffic engineer in the state. But anyway, Bill is here, and he's going to be outlining exactly what is looked at when determining whether or not a traffic light is needed, and exactly how these intersections fit. After Bill and Maureen get done, if the public should have any questions, also here this evening is Bob Malley, the Director of Public Works, and David Pickering, the Chief of Police, should there be any particular questions. But I didn't ask them to make specific presentations, thinking that the public would like a chance to talk, and you don't want to hear too much from the staff before you have a chance. So I'd like to call on Bill Bray to outline the basic issues.
Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you, Mike. Is this working? Didn't sound it for me. And I'll try to keep my comments brief, but to try to give you a basic outline of what takes place in evaluating an intersection to see, first of all, if traffic signalization is warranted, keeping in mind that the Commissioner of Transportation for the state of Maine is the regulating body for making the decision whether traffic signals are fully warranted at an intersection, and only he or she, if it happens to be appropriate, can make that decision. Signalization and whether an intersection warrants traffic sequence operation is evaluated based upon a federal highway publication, which is referred to as a Manual on Uniform Traffic Control Devices. The state of Maine has adopted that guideline for the state in regulating traffic within our state. In that manual, there are several signal warrants. In fact, there's 11 warrants that you test the conditions at an intersection to see if those conditions are met. And if they are met, then you make an engineering decision of whether the traffic signals are in the best interest of the particular operations of that intersection, or whether it would be more appropriate to do some other type of improvement. Let me just quickly give you some of the advantages of putting in traffic signals at an intersection. They obviously allow for the orderly movement of traffic through the intersection. They can increase the ability of the intersection to handle traffic. They can reduce the frequency of certain types of traffic accidents. And they can be used to interrupt the heavy flow of traffic along the major route to allow the side street traffic to enter into the major street flow. Obviously, with anything, there's also disadvantages. And let me just quickly go over three or four disadvantages that often come along with putting in traffic signals. The traffic along the major street is obviously going to be delayed. They have a free flow condition now. If you put signals in, even if the signals stay green on the side street approach for a minimal amount of time, the traffic on the through street or the major street would be delayed. It encourages people to disobey the indications that the traffic signals are displaying. For example, if one is turning from yellow to red, there's always that increased chance that people take of running through the light. Other things that can occur is that traffic may be detoured to other adjacent routes that do not have traffic signals on it. simply to avoid what they may perceive as added delay at that particular intersection. And yes, believe it or not, accident frequency can also increase at traffic signals, or certain types of accidents will increase when you install traffic signals, more than likely. That type of accident typically is categorized as a rear-end accident when the person stops short in front and the person in behind is not maybe paying as much attention as they should be, and they would collide. The manual on uniform traffic control devices is quite clear. Signals should not be installed unless you see or can make a determination that the overall safety in the intersection and the operation of that particular intersection can be improved with those traffic signals. If you cannot make an improvement or you cannot rationalize that improvement, then you are much better off not installing the traffic signals. Let me go over and discuss the 11 warrants where the conditions within an intersection are evaluated, and I'll be as brief as possible on these. There, under each of the warrants, there are two conditions. One of them is an urban condition, and then the second condition is rural areas that have a population of 10,000 people or less, or when, in some cases, the approach speed on the major street is 40 miles an hour or greater. There are two sets of criteria that you look at to analyze if the traffic signals are warranted. In Cape Elizabeth, you would use the latter one because the approach speeds, at least at one of the intersections, does exceed 40 miles an hour. And the population of the town of Cape Elizabeth is less than the 10,000 people. So I will give you the information based on that latter condition. The first warrant, which is the first and the first two warrants are the most commonly used ones in evaluating intersections. The first one would be the minimum vehicle volume. On the side street or the busy or of the two legs of an intersection, you have to maintain an average volume of 140 vehicles per hour for 8 hours on an average day. On the through street, both approaches you add together, you have to have a volume of 420 vehicles. Again, that's an average for an average day for 8 hours. The second warrant is referred to as the interruption of continuous traffic. You have to maintain a volume of 70 vehicles on the side street for a two-lane approach, and 53 if you have a single lane approach. And in the two intersections that we're discussing here this evening, you do have both cases. The through street volume would be 525 vehicles per hour when you have a single lane approach, and it would be 630 vehicles on a two-lane approach. The next warrant would be the minimum pedestrian volume warrant, and at both intersections, the conditions there do not satisfy this warrant, so I won't take the time to discuss it. The fourth warrant is a school crossing warrant. Again, neither condition satisfies the general guidelines of this warrant. Warrant five is referred to as the progressive movement, and as Mike mentioned earlier, in Portland, where we have several intersections that are adjacent to each other, oftentimes you may need to put in an added intersection and signalize it so that you can regulate the platooning of vehicles along an arterial. And that's the only case that this warrant would be used. Again, and neither one of the intersections in Cape Elizabeth would fall under that category. Warrant six is the accident experience. And at this particular warrant, you need to have an accident experience of five or more accidents per year that are susceptible to correction by traffic signals. A rear-end accident obviously is not correctable, or typically is not correctable, by installing traffic signals, but an angle collision is often the primary goal of signals. If you have an accident problem, is to try to correct that what can often be a heavily injured type of an accident with a high-speed approach along the major roadway. Warrant 7, again, is not applicable to the two intersections here. It's called a systems warrant, and again, it's more in tune with a major central business district where you have multi-intersections. Warrant 8 is a sort of catch-all type of a warrant where you combine a lesser percentage of warrants 1 and 2 to allow you to evaluate under some unique conditions. Warrant 9 would be a 4-hour volume warrant where that in this particular case you have to have a minimum volume of 60 vehicles on the side street and 80 vehicles when you have a multi-lane approach. The 10th warrant is a peak hour delay warrant, and it's exactly what it says. It refers to the amount of delay or the time involved in trying to get into the major street from the side street approaches. At one of the locations, this may be applicable, although in this case, we do not have the data at this point to make that determination. The last warrant is a peak hour volume warrant. Generally, it's used where you have a factory that has a very large volume of traffic that enters an intersection for a short duration of time, and then there's virtually nothing thereafter, although it can be used at an intersection if you want to evaluate it. But again, you have to maintain the 75 vehicles on the side street, and you have to have an approach volume total on the major street of 1,000 vehicles or more. I know it may sound a little boring, but unfortunately you have to go through this process in evaluating an intersection to really be able to avoid the liability that can go along with putting signals in or not putting them in, and there is that process that has to take place. Another thing that's done to evaluate an intersection is that we look at the capacity of that intersection, how much traffic can the intersection handle, either when it's unsignalized or when it's signalized. And in both cases, the traffic capacity of that intersection is evaluated by two different methods. When you have an unsignalized intersection, you're measuring the capacity of the intersection by looking at the gaps in the traffic stream along the major route. Typically, a gap that's acceptable for a person on the side street is 6 seconds or more. What we do is we measure the amount of gaps on that major street within the peak hour condition, and if there are a great number of gaps, which would indicate that the traffic is not of great volume and it's spaced out, then you would have a very high level of service or a high capacity at the intersection. Obviously, if the traffic is very tightly knit together, then you have a very poor capacity. We evaluate an intersection the same way as all of the kids that go to school get evaluated on their grade cards. An A is a very good intersection, and we go down, it's the same way in school, we go down to an F, which is a very, very poor intersection. When you evaluate an intersection capacity with signals, you look at the delay. How much total delay is each of the approaches in the intersection experiencing when that signal is operating? If you have a very heavily congested intersection, and again, I'll use a Portland example of Morrill's Corner, the average delay for a vehicle to go through that intersection is enormous when you compare it to something that may be on the order of a Route 77 in Spurwink, when the average delay may be less than 10 seconds. In Morrill's Corner, the average delay is well over a minute. And that's the difference between what would be considered a very good intersection and a very poor intersection. Let me just give a few facts regarding each of the intersections. Back in September of 1989, PACS, which is the area-wide transportation planning organization that the Cape is a member of, prepared a report for Cape Elizabeth evaluating the intersection of Spurwink and Route 77. Back in the time of preparation of that report, they looked at the existing accident experience of that intersection and found that there was an average of 7 accidents occurring there within a 3-year period. In evaluating those seven accidents, or the occurrences of that seven, those seven accidents, with other similar locations in the state, indicates that that intersection is on the borderline of being categorized as a high accident location within the state. Of the seven accidents, four of the accidents were angle collisions where that a vehicle from the side street collided with someone along Route 77. Back in July of 1989, there were traffic volumes taken at the intersection. The average approach volume on the westerly approach of Spurwink Avenue, the average hourly approach volume was 74 vehicles per hour. The total of both directions on Route 77 was, the average again, was 756 vehicles per hour. And this is during the daytime between roughly 7 in the morning and 6 in the evening. If any of you traveled through that intersection today, we did a very quick update to see what has happened since 1989. We only took the data for 4 hours, but during those 4 hours, the average approach volume on Spurwink Avenue has increased from 74 vehicles to 112 vehicles, which is roughly a 50% increase in the plus or minus 4 years. The through traffic along Route 77, not being a great beach day today, has more or less stayed balanced from what it was back in 1989. But again, the delay to the traffic on Spurwink Avenue has increased considerably because the volume has increased in that short period of time. That PACS report evaluated the capacity of the intersection as it sits today with a non-signalized intersection, and both side street approaches operate with considerable delay in trying to enter Route 77 or cross Route 77, and that approach capacity is probably in the neighborhood of E or F right now coming out of the side street approaches. No one has done a computation on what it would be with traffic signals, but based on my experience, I would say that with properly installed signals at that location, the average delay to the Route 77 traffic would be less than 10 seconds, and the delay to the traffic on Spurwink would be in the neighborhood of 15 to 20 seconds. So you can see a tremendous increase or an improvement in the service at the intersection. The Route 77 Scott Dyer Shore Road intersection, there was a report done in May of 1990 by T.Y. Lynn that evaluated whether or not the conditions at that intersection met the signal warrants at that time. That report, based on some data at that point, at that time, indicated that signals were in fact warranted because the through volume along Route 77, again, is significantly high enough to exceed the warrants, as well as the side street traffic on both Shore Road and Scott Dyer Road exceed the minimum standards. Based on a number of traffic studies that I've personally completed at that intersection, the accident trends going back as far as 1986 that I was able to dig up, the accident experience at that intersection varies from between 3 and 4 accidents per year. There's been some good years, and then there's been some other years where the accident numbers are a little higher. But for every 3-year period, there's anywhere from 10 to 14 accidents at the intersection. And the number of angle collisions have, again, been generally in the range of 4 angle accidents to as many as 8 angle accidents. Now, compared to other similar locations in the state, this particular intersection is a high accident location as defined by the Maine Department of Transportation. In the T.Y. Lynn report, they did evaluate the capacity of this intersection currently as it operates unsignalized, and again, both side streets are categorized at level of service F operation. With traffic signals, you would be able to operate the intersection at level of service B, or a very high standard with a minimal amount of delay to both the side street and the through street. Let me just go over, and I'll conclude here, go over a few points that you may want to be aware of with what happens and how traffic signals are actually designed. Because both intersections on Route 77, in my opinion, would be considered isolated intersections, that they are really not spaced close enough to other adjacent intersections, so you would deal with them in an isolated design standard. I would recommend that each of those intersections be designed as a semi-actuated intersection, which means that the traffic on the through street would always have a green indication unless someone on the side street would be detected by a detection device on that side street. The green would hold for a minimal amount of time along the major street, and then it would provide a green indication to the side street traffic. Once the side street traffic has cleared, then it would go back to a green indication for both through directions. Again, I would strongly recommend that they were not coordinated. Anything greater than a half mile spacing, the gain from coordinating signals is easily lost because of the interruptions that the side streets create. I would also recommend that during the non-peak hours of the day, probably somewhere in the range of maybe 8 o'clock at night or maybe even 9 o'clock at night to maybe as late as 6 o'clock in the morning, that these signals would remain on flashing operation. They can all be regulated by a time clock, so it's easily changed whether it needs to increase the time or decrease the time. And there also may even be some days of the week, possibly a Sunday, maybe a holiday, where that the town may want to flash these signals. The current understanding that I have at Spurwink Avenue, there would not be pedestrian lights installed at this particular location, but the town has had discussions with MDOT at the Route 77 Scott Dyer location and are evaluating whether pedestrian signals may in fact be an advisable inclusion with the traffic signal design. With that, I'll turn it back to you, Mike.
Thank you, Bill. Bill will be staying if anyone has any questions for him later. Well, when I did the introductions earlier, I forgot to mention that Lee Chase is here as well. Lee is the traffic engineer for the Maine Department of Transportation for Cumberland and York counties, or roughly, doesn't follow that exactly, but it's District 6 of the Maine Department of Transportation. He is here as well. Now I'd like to ask Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, to update on two issues. One is what the planning board has looked at over the last few years as far as how these intersections may be further impacted by development, as well as to outline some from of what the town center committee has discussed as well, which I didn't ask. I let her know I was going to ask her to do the second, so
I'd be happy to anyway.
Thank you.
Just to start out with developments in the area of the town center, the Elizabeth Heights Congregate Care Facility was part of the Pond Cove traffic study, and that was originally proposed to be 75 units, was dropped down to 60. So that development really is already included in the study you have, and it built in an extra capacity of 15 units. Since that time, however, the Viking Nursing Home has gotten approval for a 60-bed addition. What I did is I just went through some of the traffic studies and pulled out the numbers for the increase in peak hour PM trips. And that was talking about an estimated 7 additional trips in the peak hour and the PM. Other projects that approved since that time, the Public Works Office Addition also, that was approved. All of these projects were approved under the assumption that there was going to be a traffic signal placed at that intersection. That was approved with an assumption that there would be a decrease of 2 trips in the PM peak hour, but an increase of 10 trips in the AM. The community center was approved with an assumption that didn't have a specific traffic study for it, but it did have a very rough calculation of additional trips with a total PM additional trips of 13 in the evening peak hour. The Scout House, which was approved just recently as a conversion from a vacant use to a retail use, was assumed to have an additional 7.8 trips in the evening peak hour. And there was another project that was proposed for the the white Sheer Madness building and the yellow building next to it, which has not been approved yet, but if those areas were converted as proposed to an amount of office space, an additional 10 trips was proposed for the evening peak hour. The traffic study that was submitted for the Public Works office addition, again, assumed that there was going to be a signal at that intersection, and with the signal, it was assumed that the level of service for that intersection would be level of service B. The one other thing you may want to think about, which really hasn't been discussed and I don't think has been looked at in this town center intersection, has been something the town center committee's been talking about, and that's making the town center more pedestrian-friendly as well as vehicle-friendly. And this intersection is one that right now I think is very difficult for pedestrians to negotiate for a variety of reasons, and a traffic signal may make that a lot easier for pedestrians. Any questions?
As with Mr. Bray, Ms. O'Meara will be available for questions that do arise during our public hearing. Are those all the staff comments we're expecting? All right. I would like to just let you know about three letters that have been received by councilors regarding this issue. One from Gertrude Hamm, who is addressing the proposed light at Spurwink Avenue, saying she does favor that installation, believing that there is a safety problem there. Second letter from Gregory Walsh and Louise Bellotti, addressing both lights. They are opposed to both lights, feeling that there does not seem to be a need for either of the lights. And the third is a letter from Bruce Cogshaw, who is the chairman of our Town Center Planning Committee, which Maureen was just referring to. And to summarize the committee's position, he writes, it would prefer not to have a traffic light. And this is referring to the intersection of 77 with Scott Dyer and Shore Road. Prefer not to have a traffic light if other acceptable alternatives can be found. But it would support the installation of a traffic light if there is no other practical alternative, and if the light will, in fact, take care of the traffic and safety problems at this intersection. So those are the three letters that all the councilors, I believe, do have received copies of. I know I, as a councilor, have received a number of phone calls and been stopped by a number of people throughout town in different places, and I would imagine some of the other councilors have also. What I'd like to do is open the public hearing. When you come to the podium to speak, please give us your name and your address. And if you are making some points, please be succinct. There are others in the audience, and we may get to the point if a lot of people do not have good time to speak, we may just take a hand vote. I'm hoping that people will be brief enough that everybody who wants a chance to speak will have that opportunity. At the end of the public hearing, if there are questions that Mr. Bray and Ms. O'Meara can address, then we will ask them to do so. Okay, we're here to have your input tonight for you to ask questions of our consultants and our staff. We will not be making a vote about this issue this evening. We decided that last month that it was the general consensus of the council that we wanted to have two public hearings on this. So we're here tonight for educational purposes, for everybody to have a better understanding of the facts in this issue and to get some of your questions answered, so that will help you and help the councilors. Okay. Yes, sir.
Kevin, some points.
We need you at the podium if you're going to say anything. That's where the microphone is. People at home need to hear.
My name is Wayne Anderson. I live on Shore Road, 597. As a point of clarification, I'd like to ask before we go further. Number one, on the 1989 study, what 4 hours were involved in terms of determining the traffic pattern?
I don't want to get into a discussion with the consultants. If questions seem appropriate to be answered on the spot, maybe we can do that. Otherwise, we're going to save the questions.
Will they be addressed at a later time, or will they be made of them?
Yeah.
at least to my understanding, in terms of the 11 warrants that were necessary in terms of determining lights, I only heard one of them being satisfied. That's a question. I have some issues that I would like to lay out and some questions. The first issue is a money question in terms of the state being offering money to the Cape to put in the system. Is that true?
That is true. that we can do.
The main issue I have is that there's a real increase in pedestrian and bike traffic in Cape Elizabeth, particularly on Shore Road and Spurwink. 77 is nicely set up with bike paths and walking paths. The other two are not. And if traffic is diverted because of two lights onto Spurwink and onto Shore Road, then you have a real safety issue. There's a real safety issue now. That's it for my comments.
Okay, thank you very much. Yes, sir?
My name is Bob Tripler. I live on Trendy Road in Shore Acres, and I've been here just exactly 2 years, although I've been summering in Maine for 30. We finally moved here, and we come from a suburban area that increasingly added stop signs, added traffic lights, as well as adding people, of course. And we found that the more controls you put on people, the more lawlessness there is. And now, we just visited last week this area that we moved from, and nobody stops for traffic, nobody stops for stop signs anymore. They just roll right through them. They pass the red lights. I mean, they're so eager to beat this orange light that most of them are passing red lights now. And I breathed a sigh of relief when we came back here to an area where I have never, to my knowledge, and I've tried at different times. I'm retired, so I can travel at different times of the day. And so I tried it during school hours. I've tried it in the evenings and so forth, and even on a late Saturday afternoon when the beach traffic was coming back. And I've never had to wait to cross one of these, cross 77, any longer than it would take a traffic light to change. And so I'm firmly against this. I think that it's a waste of money. I think that the accident rate does not seem excessive to me. As a matter of fact, when I first heard about this, I went into the police department, and I asked them, I said, gee, I heard about this light that they're proposing. Has there been a lot of accidents there? He didn't know about any. Of course, he didn't do a study, but, I mean, his experience as a policeman was not such that he was aware that, gee, we better do something about this. So that's my input for what it's worth.
Thank you very much.
Fun.
Gentlemen, we'd like to keep the discussion flowing. Yes, sir, in the front row. Please do. We'd like you with the microphone so everybody can hear what you have to say.
I am
excuse me, sir.
In my throat.
If those in the audience could give your attention to the speaker, please. Thank you.
I am Roger Ray, and I live in the Canterbury development. I have drawn a map, which possibly people can see better if I move this lectern out of the way and bring this thing forward a little.
I see some helpers.
I think Mr. Chappelle is not going to be able to see at all. We'll tell him about it.
He's a good listener.
You've had me in the dark before, Roger.
Okay, I'm good. You want to bring it over?
Well, I don't know. But I guess that would
that's good. Everybody's here.
You. Now, I wish to speak because I think this is a very dangerous intersection. There have been accidents there. I feel that it is only by great good fortune that no one has yet been killed there. And the couple sitting next to me, victims of one of the accidents that was very serious. Now this little map By the way, I don't qualify very well as a map drawer, nor have I taken any courses in lettering. But if you can bear with me, I have attempted to draw the intersection of Spurlink and Route 77, which is Ocean House Road. The reason that I feel the map is helpful is because of the difference in the lay of the land from just what a black and white drawing would show. For example, there is a hollow in here, and the ground rises here, so that an automobile at this point does not see the traffic coming toward him until it gets to the high ground right here. Similarly, this land is lower here, and it rises when it gets to this intersection, so that people coming here don't see a car on the west side of Spurlink until it is at the intersection. Now, from the Cape going north towards South Portland, there is a hollow about where the sea and Cape is. You see the cars when you're here. You see the cars once they come out of the hollow and they're right here. Now, if there is a red light or a green light, that is visible, certainly. I think there are great difficulties due to the hollows and the rises in the land on the approach, both on the west side of Spurlink and the north side of Route 77 and the south side of Route 77, so that it is difficult to see without getting to the exact point of the intersection. Now, there is a blinker there. Maybe people have gotten very used to it. Maybe people have other things in their minds. But certainly when they are paying no attention to the traffic caution, which that would call for, they're going at a rather considerable speed. If there is to be a stop, they have a very short distance to register that stop on the foot brake because of the visibility problems. I have drawn this picture, and I support what the man has said in the way of statistics, because it seems to be a dangerous situation now, and do you have to wait until someone is killed? That's the end of my speech.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ray. We appreciate your graphic as well. Thank you, Rosemary. Yes, ma'am. Perhaps we can move the podium back so it's not quite so.
Glad you came, Rosemary.
You've graduated from the council.
I'm Val DeGrass, and I live on Spurlink, Ocean House Road, and my house is a second house on the road, and you can see the light. My husband and I were coming home one afternoon. It's a year ago last June. Is that right, Bob? At 3:15 in the afternoon. And little did I know that what was going to happen to us. We were had our car with the blinker light on, turning to go into our garage, and we have a rise in our driveway. So the electric door opener was up, and we were wanting to turn, but we were waiting for a car coming north to pass. And all I remember is my husband looking in the rear mirror and saying, oh no, and that's the last I remember. And we were taken to the hospital. I had an arm out of the socket for 5 hours. It still isn't good. And even with 7 months of therapy, I'm still not able to get it up unless I pull it up. I have a broken left foot in two places, a broken nose. I'm 71 years old, and I know my nose wasn't pretty before, but it's even worse now. But I really have suffered emotionally. It's been a bad experience for us. My husband has heart trouble. He had the sternum bone broken in his chest, another bone. He cut his head. He cut his hand very deep with 7 stitches. And I don't remember anything until 11:30 that night when they released me from the hospital. And first they thought I had a broken neck. I've got the tape here. And the boys next door to me, our new neighbors, took a videotape, and they just happened to have their camera out. It's the strangest thing. And took the picture of everything happening from the moment it took place. So there were ambulances in all directions. The roads was cut off. There was no direction, you know, nobody was able to go in any direction, really. They rerouted them, you know, to where they could get in their homes and things. But it's been bad. Our house is up for sale. We've had several look at it, and when they come with children, they see the where there's a light, just a blink of light. And their children ride bicycles, they said, and they just don't want to be there. And it's been hard to sell our house because of that situation right there. It's still up for sale. It probably will, you know, not move. I don't know. But that's the case. And really, it's left me pretty bad. That's all I've got to say. But you have to go through it to know. And that's all I can say. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Or somebody else. Yes, ma'am. You. Mm-hmm.
My name is Barbara Durden.
Sit down.
All right. Can you hear me now? Okay. My name is Barbara Durden, and I'm very sorry for these people here. I, too, had an accident, and I'm all for safety, and I do want to see these lights. My accident was about in 85, and it was on Spurlink Avenue as I was making a turn down my street, State Avenue, and I believe if we had had lights there, the dump truck that totaled my car, fortunately, I was not hurt, possibly would have stopped and would not have fallen asleep at the wheel as he did, and I would still perhaps have had my car. I do think it's very important that we have a light there. Safety first. I believe that lights were invented for that probably in the beginning. So because of my traumatic experience, I don't like to see things like that happen. I certainly did enjoy it, and I was impressed by the story tonight, and I, for one, am for the light. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, sir.
My name is Lawrence Ralston. I'm a 10-year resident of Cape Elizabeth, live at 12 Waven Road. I've become aware that there's a strong feeling in town that this increase in signaling would, as they say, seriously threaten the rural character of Cape Elizabeth. I disagree, and very, very briefly, would like to tell those who of that opinion why. Firstly, Cape Elizabeth already has two lights. The ones we are discussing, our disagreement is about the way they should be used. I myself am in agreement with those who want a fixed light operation during the limited times when this would be most needed. As I've seen it, the rush hour, particularly 3 to 4 p.m. southbound, and then also the weekends, Saturdays and Sundays in summer and good weather, just give us an impenetrable traffic flow. Mornings really south on 77 and then the return in the afternoon. I think the absolutely minimal distraction from the rural character of this town that lights would mean is far outdistanced by the increase in safety that they would bring.
Thank you, Mr. Ralston. Dave.
David Laurie, 189 Spurlink Avenue.
I'd like to use this map here for a second just to reinforce what was said earlier. The grades at this intersection make it particularly dangerous. Coming up Spurwink towards 77, the grade is such that you really have to pull up almost into the intersection before you can see. At that point in time, you have to pull up way beyond the stop sign before you can see what traffic is coming. And then the traffic, then you have to wait while the car is coming down 77, turn around you. You often see cars sitting out there in the middle of the intersection, and often it's my car sitting out there in the intersection, with cars turning around me, or else I'm turning around them. And that particular maneuver is, I think, particularly in the wintertime, very, very dangerous. There needs to be some certainty on the part of the person, at least during rush hours, that they don't, that they can go forward into that intersection, they can complete the turn. You know, if you had a stoplight there, you could stop further down. You wouldn't have to pull all the way up because you could wait till it turned green, then you could pull up there. Of course, if it's flashing some of the time, then I guess you got to still take your chances at that point. But I don't see this as an issue of delay and whether I'm going to be delayed more or less in getting into the intersection. It's purely a public safety issue. And if you wait much longer, it's somebody will be killed at that intersection. It's inevitable. It's just it's waiting to happen. The other things about this intersection which are particularly bad, the gentleman before talked about the grade coming up from the hollow in South Portland down here, so that you can't see each other coming around there. But the other thing which is interesting, I didn't notice it until I bought my house down here next to Maxwell's Farm, and I was moving from my house over in Oakhurst, and I was driving a van. And I hadn't noticed it when I was in a car, but when you pull out, I don't know if you can see this, when you pull out here, when you're over there, on that part of the intersection, in a van, the angle is such that you can't see across here at all. You really can't see across there at all. It's almost impossible to see at the best of times. It's difficult enough in a car. In a van, it's impossible. The fellow who was accompanying me had to get out of the car here, walk over there, and let me know when it was clear to cross 77 there, because the traffic was such and the angles are such that you just could not see around the corner of the van. Sitting in a cab of a, it wasn't a van, it was a truck, excuse me. You just could not see to get across there. But as I said before, the problem that I have every day is right here. Every day I got to pull up into that intersection before I can see that it's safe to turn. I'm out into that intersection with cars turning around me. And believe me, I'm not the only one. That's the only way that people can negotiate that intersection to turn left or to go straight. They got to pull right up into it and then stop. And wait.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
My name is Jack Lustig. I am a resident of Kildare Road, Cape Elizabeth. Very, very proudly say a resident of Cape Elizabeth for many, many years. I look at this, and I'll tell you, I am opposed to the traffic light. The basic reason is, I feel, when are we as citizens of this community and of this state going to accept responsibility for our own actions? We cannot look to a town, we cannot look to a state to protect us from cradle to grave. This is not our society. If you are a good driver and you are approaching that intersection, you know when to slow down. And believe me, I am not speaking of 5 days a week going to work, driving 21 miles a day, and maybe going shopping. I am speaking of a 35-year on-the-road driving record covering everything from Newport, Rhode Island to Messina, New York, and from Fort Kent, Maine, all the way down to Cape Cod. There is nothing that is going to remedy a careless driver. Rear-end collisions, be they a traffic light or not a traffic light, will always happen. When people are making a left-hand turn into oncoming traffic, it is a jeopardy that we all face every single day when we're driving. And if you want to see some major accidents, especially on Spurwink and Ocean House Road, you put yourself a light up there and watch the acceleration to beat that yellow light before it turns red, coming out of that blind. And I will safely say to you that we will see more mayhem on that particular corner than we have ever seen before. It's cruel and it's cool to say that 3 to 5 accidents at an intersection like that in a year is not major. They have many more accidents on protected corners with traffic lights. I just rebel against the fact that this is another feature in controlling and controlling the population by new rules, regulations, and laws. And if we're talking about an accident rate and we're talking about something that has to be done, when does a week go by that there isn't some sort of an accident on Route 77 with some of our deer problem here? And what are we doing to protect the citizens of Cape Elizabeth against that? I have yet to pick up a copy of the Cape Courier that there isn't at least one accident. Now, are we giving the wildlife of Cape Elizabeth more freedom than we are the citizens of this city, of this town? I see no need for it until there are more precautions being taken. If the people feel that strongly about it, what about a four-way stop sign? What about a reduction in speed? Traffic lights do not remedy a situation. They make it even worse. And already by your own projections, we are putting in a traffic light to turn it on blinker Saturdays, Sundays, and holidays, and we're going to turn it on blinker 11 hours a day. You are eliminating half of the hours of the day that the light is going to be working. And when you add up all of your weekends and all of your holidays, it's not going to help. I am very, very sorry to say there is no control over careless driving and people that refuse to take responsibility for their own actions. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Please, Eric.
I'm John Herrick. I live on 29 Reef Road and have been a resident for over 15 years. I hope and I trust you will treat these two intersections entirely independently. I came down here with an attitude to be open, but I'm really not in favor of traffic lights. However, there very well may be a case for a traffic light at the Spurwink Route 77 intersection. I'm not sure about that because I believe, like the previous speaker, that traffic lights don't stop cars. People stop cars. And if a person's going to get careless going through that intersection, they'll run a red light. And it may be the severity of the accident may be actually increased, as I think the traffic expert from Portland indicated. The severity may actually increase with a stoplight there. I'm not sure about that, but that's an observation that I could think of. As far as the Scott Dyer Shore Road intersection is concerned, I think that's a much safer intersection. I go through that, like all of us, I'm sure, many, many times. On Saturday, I went through there several times between 11:30 and 12, and that was a good beach day, and people are going to the dump and going on their errands, and from any direction, I didn't have to wait more than just seconds, and I was through there, and very, very safely. And that's been happening for 15 years. The visibility is good at that intersection. I think everybody knows about it. They slow down. We're very careful. And I think that's important to try to maintain a sense that we should be careful going through these intersections. And perhaps if we put a stoplight there,
people may start looking at the stoplight instead of looking at oncoming cars, and there's a possibility we may again have the person going through the red light and creating a serious accident. So I prefer to see you treat these two intersections very independently. I think there's a stronger case for the Sperwick Avenue light. I think the putting a light, stoplight at Scott Dyer Road should be considered very, very carefully. To me, this is not an issue of the rural character of the town. It's an issue of safety for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
My name is Clint Fecto. I live at 4 Rand Road in Cape Elizabeth. If you're not familiar with that, it's right in behind the Cumberland Farms store, the first street off in Hillway, or in between that and 77. I have lived there for about 28 years. I think probably as much as anybody in town, I get to meet the Scott Dyer 77 intersection probably 3, 4, 5 times a day because I go up there frequently, go walking in the morning, see the chief of police coming to work, and I wave to him once in a while. And Jim Murray, I see him on his way to work in the morning. I go up there to pick up things that my wife happens to forget that we need to cook with. But I get up there quite frequently, go up to drop mail in the post office box. So I use that intersection quite frequently. This one here, I have no experience with, going down 77. And I want to say that my objection to any red light there, I don't care who it is in the city of town of Cape Elizabeth. I don't think anybody uses it more frequently than I do, and I have never had a problem getting through that intersection. And having been there, as I say, for about 28 years, all times of the day, we go to the dump and go down to the Bond Cove shopping center. I use it for whatever you want to think of. I walk through it at least once a day when I go out for exercise, when I walk in the morning or afternoon, whatever it may be. And we don't need a traffic light there. My own feeling is that for the town of Cape Elizabeth and for the state of Maine to spend money putting a traffic light there is a waste of the taxpayers' money, whether it be on a local level or on the state of Maine level. And I don't know if the federal government is involved in that or not, but we just don't need it. I have never had a problem getting through that intersection in the state in 28 years. And I lived below that on 151 Ocean House Road for 7 years prior to moving up to Rand Road. So I've had a little bit of experience over 30-some-odd years in Cape Elizabeth on that road. And I say, why now? Here, maybe an argument. I don't have any experience with that. I just go down 77 when I'm going into South Portland. But for anybody to get up there and say we have a problem in this intersection, no, no, no. And with one of the speakers before me, I have been driving 25 to 30,000 miles a year for over 30 years on the road, and people cause accidents. Stoplights don't prevent them. They make just as many accidents as they prevent. So I object to that. I object to my money being spent as a taxpayer in Cape Elizabeth. I object to my money being spent as a taxpayer in the state of Maine on this type of expenditure. Here, I have no opinion on that. You go what you want with that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Is there anybody else? Yes, sir.
My name is William Richardson. I live in Old Ocean House Road. I've lived here for 40 years. I've gone through both those intersections many times every day, and I've never had a problem with the traffic. I appreciate the deer problem, but we got to remember that deer are colorblind if we're going to have to deal with that one.
Thank you for that reminder, Mr. Richardson. Anybody else, Bob?
My name is Bob Curtis, and live on Columbus Road. I don't support the lights primarily because I have a hard enough time getting out of my own road. And I think if, you know, the people that are here, a lot of them are talking because they live on the intersections. I think if we had lights at other intersections, you'd have the same thing happen. I live on I have to come out of Mitchell Road a lot onto 77, and that intersection's as bad as either one of these two. I've never had any problem at either one of them. I've only lived here 4 years. I spent 22 years in the service, and I grew up in Maine. And driving around after I came back, a lot of the street lights that were here 25 years ago are gone because they did not stop people from going through intersections. They didn't stop accidents. They got worse, and people really started to die. You know, they took a good look at the traffic flow. You know, if there's a problem on either one of these intersections, make it, if you're looking at safety, make it a four-way stop sign. Then everybody stops. Reduce the speed limit to 20 miles an hour. And get the police out there from the town to enforce the speed limit, enforce the stop signs. But I support the people here that have said, if you put the stoplights in, you're gonna have some accidents and somebody's gonna die. You know, we've got a lot of other problems in this town. We don't need to add to them. And I have one question on, I don't know what it's gonna cost to maintain it, but I do drive to Biddeford and Saco occasionally, about 2-3 times a week. And in the 4 years I've been here, I know of at least 3 lights that have been put in on Route 1 that are now no longer there. Now, I don't know how much it costs to put them in and to take them out and to maintain them, but if we're only going to put the light in and use it 4 or 5 hours a day during the summer, I don't know if it's realistic. You know, if you really think it's a safety problem, look at it, and if it is, put in a four-way stop sign. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Is there anybody else? Yes, sir.
Ken Maxwell. I've crossed the corner a few times in the past few years. If I told you how many times I crossed that in a day, you'd treat me like Jonah and throw me overboard and figure that might solve your problem, perhaps. I have crossed it with all kinds of farm equipment, from large to small, and my only problem is I'm not a dairy farmer, so I do not have the one piece of equipment that might really command respect. That's a loaded manure spreader, you know. Sometimes they'll keep away from those. I saw a cartoon once of a dairy farmer who couldn't get his cows across the road to milk them twice a day during the busy traffic, so he filled up the manure spreader and backed it up to the highway, and you can imagine what the cartoonist did with that. The scenario is quite clever. I don't know the answer to this. The last gentleman and some of the others said maybe there's other solutions, but I do feel as we're coming to where we have got to have a solution, something there to protect the cross traffic. And I will deal primarily with Spelink Avenue. But by the way, I do have a little more faith in Bill Bray now since he's got those automated ones going across Portland. Previous to that, he had short circuits and everything else going, and so you hit a red light every time. But now I feel a little better with him now. I see two things. One is, of course, I'm coming from this end of Spillink Avenue, and of course, Spillink Avenue, it's not a cross, it's a slash. By the time this traffic pulls out, Mr. Lurie related to a problem going this way, but by the time we come out so we can see out to the Cape, we have completely blocked any possibility of someone coming here and turning around. We either have to back up to let them go in front of us, or they've got to sit out there until something is done. If there was a right angle approach, you could stop. I mean, you know, as he said, we go way by the traffic sign, and the neighbors here at the house have been gracious. They've limbed up the trees and everything pretty well, but we've got to get the nose of our equipment and things right out to the bike lane in order to see both ways. And by then, you have absolutely blocked any possibility of a left turn coming out of Portland. That to me, is one of the largest problems there. And then combined with that is the traffic has increased. I see more and more of impatience, shall we say, and people, you know, just wanting to try to sneak through that smaller and smaller opening. And we know what that's headed for. They're just gambling more and more, waiting. And of course, we sit there with a tractor or a low bid tractor, a tracking thing, looking towards Portland, trying to see if we've got room enough to make a left turn out to the Cape. And there's times you wait there a long time. And I've swung out there many times and just got out into the travel lane and starting to pick up speed. When I'd say for sure someone was right on the tail end of my low bid, and I said, where did they come from? Because it is a time-consuming process to do that. The traffic has increased, as we know, and I feel as though that we've got to have a traffic light there. It's like you could put in a circle, you could put in one-way traffic, you could do all kinds of things, and I don't see that that's practical at all. I've been a, you know, you gave Jim Murray an award here. I've been a fireman for 35 years. I was a flunky when I started. I still am now. But I'm not going to enjoy waiting for a traffic light when I'm answering a fire call. And there's going to be some strained emotions here if you put in both of these lights. And the new chief will have some things to lay out to make sure the volunteers obey these traffic lights. I bore it sitting in a mechanical monster that tells me I must sit here even though there's no traffic coming the other way. And yet, I survive going down through Sawyer Street and Highland Avenue and those lights, even though I know they're all aimed for the cross traffic because they're in South Portland and they do nothing for the town of Cape Elizabeth, but I do survive through it. And if we have to have one more or two more, I don't feel it's the end of life. I do feel that the police and the traffic engineers and these people who are up on the safety issue, I think they're the ones that you should really listen to, and I may like it or dislike it, but I feel as though you've got to make a practical decision on what's best, and safety is the one factor you've got to listen to. So thank you.
Thank you, sir. Would anybody else like to speak? Yes, sir.
Jim Murray. I'd like to ask Bill, using this as Scott Dyer, this one is Shore Road. Bill, if there was a light here at the center, I own a construction company at 1230, which is just back from that light. And my tractor trailer from stem to stern is 62 feet long, and it is a dog and pony show to come out on that intersection and try to get down headed towards Tulip. So to get out, I need about an acre and a half in this corner to get go. Okay. If there was a light there, where would traffic be stopped here on Route 77 going towards Two Lights and here going towards South Pole? And also, that lane coming up from south and going on to Shore Road to head towards Fort Williams. How far back from that intersection would you?
He will answer that at the end. Okay. We're not going to take individual questions. Right. Did you have any other questions?
No, that's all I got.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Rosemary?
Rosemary Reed, 197 Ocean House Road. My question is regarding the accident at those intersections. If the accidents that were identified were only those involving two motor vehicles, or if the accidents involving pedestrians or bicyclists were also included in the study. And for 5 years I have lived on Route 77. My car has been totaled shortly above the Spurwink intersection in my attempt to turn left. It was right beyond that intersection, but the traffic had flowed through there, and the person was traveling at excessive speeds, and I just want you to know that accidents do happen on certain parts of town because of driver inattention. This woman suggested she didn't see my blinker, and I suggested she didn't see my car. But the point is, this town is going to continue to grow. I'm sorry, I always get nervous. I don't know why. Accidents are always going to happen in places where there are not mechanized lights. And this town is going to continue to grow. There are plans that are going to come before the people of Cape Elizabeth regarding changes in where our schools are placed and in traffic patterns, perhaps, because of the parking lots, and also a probable request for sidewalks or something of that extent that would allow for increased pedestrian traffic specifically. There will be more school students that will probably be walking to school instead of being bused. One of the expenses we have as taxpayers is supporting student transportation, and right now almost all of our students are transported by bus because there are no sidewalks and there are no ways for students to carefully and without danger cross major intersections. So I would respectfully request that those considerations also be included in the discussion before a decision is made. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who would like to speak? Mr. Adams?
My name is Henry Adams. I live at Todd Road, which is off of Shore Road. Excuse me. I was going to save my remarks until the hearing in September because I'm accumulating a lot of information, but I guess there's some questions that I need answered before September. The traffic engineer stated that the Scott Dyer Shore Road Route 77 intersection had precedence for a stoplight over the one down here at Spurwink and 77. And listening to people talk, I get the distinct impression that the intersection at Spurwink and Route 77 appears to be more serious than the one right here we affectionately call the corner. And I can attest to this intersection because I drive an emergency vehicle, and I don't care whether I'm coming this way or this way, it is very difficult to get out into Route 77 and get going in toward the hospital either way. And I think Ken Maxwell and the other gentleman before him alluded to the problems. You have to stick your nose way out before you will get anywhere. It'd be nice if we had a stoplight there and a little gadget on the unit so you could turn it red when you went through. The other question I have with the traffic engineer is we talk about the intersection at the corner, but we've got the bank feeding into that intersection, we've got Balfour's feeding into the intersection, we've got Jonesy's gas station feeding into the intersection. The only one that doesn't feed into the intersection right there is Cumberland Farms because they don't have an opening right there. It's down 77 or it's down Scott Dyer Road. So I would like that subject addressed before the September hearing, because how's that? I just can't visualize how a traffic light there is going to control the maze of traffic that that winds its way through there. And I want to add something to what a lot of people have said. I have had no trouble getting through that intersection. I've never had any trouble getting through the intersection. Whether I'm going to the dump...
Please hold your applause.
Whether I'm going to the dump... Excuse me, whether I'm going to the transfer station, whether I'm going over to get a paper, whether I'm going down to mail a letter, whether I'm going up to the station on an emergency call, I have not had any problems going through the intersection, even on the busiest of summer days. So that it appears to me that this thing is just reversed, that somehow this Spurwink Avenue one seems to be taking precedence over the other. Another thing I would like to dispel, the papers have got a lot of hype going that all of this is a fight over a rural town versus a suburban town. The rural character of Cape Elizabeth was gone when we built Route 77 bypass on Rands Hill and The rural character of Cape Elizabeth was gone when the forests, the fields, and the farms were served up to the hordes of developers that have swarmed over us. So we're no longer a rural farming town. We've been transformed long ago, and I guess we didn't notice it. But, the other thing I'd like to know is how much money does the state and federal government going to give us?
Okay.
Supposedly.
We will have that information.
You know, and I would like to put a caveat to that amount of money. I would rather see that amount of money spent to fix up the despicable area route along Shore Road where Pond Cove makes in. Why don't we fix that road up once and for all? Let's spend the money down there where it's really needed. And I said facetiously the other day, I guess, to the town manager and to you that if we're going to put a stoplight in, I'd rather see it done by the IGA. I can't get out of there.
Thank you, Mr. Adams. Is there anybody else who would like to speak? Yes, ma'am.
My name is Nancy Trinward. I've been a resident of this town for 8 years. I intended to come here to listen and learn, and that's all. And I assure you that I've done both, but I feel compelled to share with you some experiences I've had with the original picture that was up here, the Spurwink Ocean House Road. I live about a mile out Spurwink Road, and I travel this road at least twice a day each way. Some days I travel it more. In the morning, coming out here onto the intersection at Route 77, although I have never been in an accident, I have witnessed two, and I was in the back seat of the car when my father was driving, and pardon my emotion, but it was pretty scary because we almost got hit very hard here. And that was at 1 o'clock in the afternoon on a Sunday. Scared the hell out of me, as it did my mother. That was not a heavy time of day, not a lot of traffic. But as we've heard 100 times tonight, coming up into this intersection, if you're looking this way, for cars coming here, cars coming here, cars coming here, and you gotta be going like this, and then you go to take your one shot to get out of there, it's pretty easy to miss some of this traffic that's traveling very fast in this direction. Frankly, my experience observing coming from this direction and coming from this direction is that the most dangerous part are these two lanes. Because if I'm coming out here trying to get down here to go into Portland, and this guy's coming here and trying to get this way to go into Cape, we're both just jimmying to get out there first. And with the incline here, and this is fairly flat, some of us do have type A personalities, and we want to get out there. And it's just unsafe, and I'm not suggesting that we put a light in there. I'm just wanted to be sure you were had the experience from some folks who use this on a real regular basis. I personally would like us to not have to have a traffic light. I live here partly because we are a rural area, if you will. So that's it.
Thank you very much. Is there somebody else who'd like to speak? Anybody else? Thank you. We will close the public hearing. Mr. Bray, would you please come up and respond to some... Whoops! Semi-close the public hearing. Come up.
My name is McManamy. I live at 1208 Shore Road. I'm a resident of Cape Elizabeth for 50 years. I think I exceed most everybody, but perhaps Bill Jordan and maybe Irvin Chappell. I've witnessed this town grow. It's a very active town. And I think the chief problem that we're facing is that Route 77, Ocean House Road, is no longer a cow pasture. It's not a primrose path, but it's a very active highway. And the whole problem is simply that Spurwink Road, Shore Road, and any other roads are in a position not to be able to enter the traffic in an appropriate manner. I must condemn 4 stopways. If you put in stop signs at 4 ways, you don't have a flow of traffic. You have a constant stop, 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 stop. And anybody that goes in town where there are four-way traffic, this is a constant thing. Now, if you have a red light, you have it stopped. When it goes green, everybody moves. I think the worst thing you could possibly do is put in four-way stop signs. It's cheap, but it's, I think, rather the wrong thing to do. Now, I feel the town of Cape Elizabeth has passed out of the stage of bucolic simplicity. I think we're a very active, progressive town, and we ought to move up to proper control of traffic lights. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Please hold your applause, ladies and gentlemen. Is there anybody else who would like to speak? Yes, sir.
My name is Chuck Keough, and I live on Valley Road. It's over here in the Mosquito area. And I travel this Spurwink Avenue every day at least twice, and I agree with everything that everybody has said here tonight, pro and con, but I also, well, it's all true.
Okay. You can.
I too am nervous.
That's fine.
I agree with everything that everybody has said, pro and con, tonight with this intersection here, but I still believe if the speed on this street is not reduced significantly, because now I think everybody goes through this intersection at least 45 miles an hour. If we can't reduce the speed here, you have to put traffic lights. And that's all I have to say.
Thank you, sir. Is there anybody else who would like to speak this evening? Please remember, we will be having another public hearing next month. Seeing no other speakers, we will close the public hearing. Mr. Bray, would you like to come up and please respond to some of the comments and questions?
I wrote down five questions. There may be more that I missed, but let me answer the five. The first question was what hours, and it was referring to the Spurwink Route 77 intersection, were the traffic counts taken. The information back in 1989 was collected between the hours of 7 o'clock in the morning to 5 o'clock in the afternoon. The one that was done actually today was collected between 2 in the afternoon and 6 in the afternoon. The other piece of information that the same gentleman asked that I didn't mention when I gave you a briefing on it was what warrants currently are met at each of the two intersections. At Route 77 in Spurwink, based on the information that's available today, it would appear to me that warrant number 2 and warrant number 9 is met under existing conditions at that location. At the second location, the Route 77 and the Scott Dyer Road intersection, again, based on the information that was provided to me, it would appear that warrants 1, 2, 9, and 11 are met at that particular intersection. There was another question asked about what times of day that the traffic accidents occurred. Looking back over the information that I have, which is not current information, but it is at least an example of what probably occurs at the intersection. At the Spurwink intersection, it was for the years 1986 through 1988. Six of the seven accidents occurred between 8 o'clock in the morning and 5:20 in the afternoon. The seventh accident occurred early in the morning, very early in the morning. At the Route 77 Scott Dyer Road intersection, 8 of the 9 accidents occurred between 7:40 in the morning and 4:10 in the afternoon. It appears that there is and I don't have the dates of these, whether they're during the summer or whether they're occurring during different times of the year. Further research and you'd be able to get the information. I just don't have it at this point. There was a question asked about the stop line location at the Shore Road Scott Dyer intersection. That's something that obviously would have to be addressed during design final design of the project. That hasn't been done by MDOT at this time, but I'm certainly sure that they would be needing that piece of information so that they would be able to adjust those stop line locations accordingly. There was another question that was asked of what types of accidents. Again, based on the limited information that I have available here this evening, there were two accidents involving bicyclists at the Shore Road Scott Dyer intersection for the 3 years of information that I have. At the Spurwink intersection, it would appear that all of the accidents involved motor vehicles, and the majority of those accidents were multi-vehicle accidents, so that there were at least two vehicles involved in the accident. The Shore Road, Scott Dyer Road intersection, another question was asked about the driveways and in the intersection itself, how will those be handled? Again, that's a design issue. Obviously, it has to be a very important decision on how you handle that traffic leading in and out of the small driveways that happen to be in the intersection. You may, for example, you may need to do some added channelization to restrict how those driveways work. You may have to control them, believe it or not, with a traffic signal, or you may be able to simply control them with a stop sign. Either or a combination of any of those ideas may be what ultimately comes out. I can't answer that here this evening. The last question, and I don't have the exact dollar amounts, but there was a question on how much it costs to install traffic signals and what proportional share would be the responsibility of the different funding agencies. Typically, you can install a set of traffic signals from anywhere from $20,000 to as much as $60,000 to $65,000, depending on how elaborate you want to make that intersection. If you go with just a simple wood pole cable hanging from the poles, you can usually install them from around $20,000 to $25,000. If you start getting into ornamental poles with either mast arms or maybe pedestals, then you're talking somewhere in the range of $50,000 to as much as $65,000. If you want to bury your cables underground, obviously that's going to be an added expense because you have to, excavate the pavement across the street and bury that conduit, which can be very costly. Generally, and I will not hold, these numbers cannot be held to exactly, but typically the state picks up 5% of the cost, the municipality pays 20% of the cost, and the federal government pays the other 75%. Sometimes those numbers are altered slightly depending on the particular location that's being under construction, but that's the general guideline that's used in allocating the funds for a project. That's all the questions that I wrote down. I'm not sure if I missed some other ones.
Did you have any others that were best answered by Mr. Byrne?
No, I think that answered them all. The other, just on the funding point, under the new federal legislation, the federal government picks up an additional 5% of actual construction, but not of the planning and design costs. So it turns out on this, the town would fund around 18% of the cost of each light with the balances left. The other question, really wasn't a question, but a comment that Henry Adams made about the emergency traffic. We did have some discussions with MDOT about whether or not it could be tied into the station. And it can be, and the plan would be that any emergency vehicle leaving the station would radio to the dispatcher, change the lights or whatever they want to say, and they can arrange it so that all of the lights are red except for the direction that the emergency vehicle is going. And then they just simply radio would clear the intersection. So that way the emergency vehicle would have the direct shot through the intersection and all other traffic would be stopped except that moving in the same direction as the emergency vehicle.
Mr. Bray, would you just hang in there? I'm sure councilors will have questions for you.
Yeah.
Mr. Curtis had a question on maintenance.
Yeah, Chairman McLaughlin is whispering to me about the maintenance cost. The current blinkers cost approximately $500 a piece or $1,000 a year to operate. The new lights, according to the senior traffic engineer at the Maine Department of Transportation, would cost an additional $1,000 per year per light, or per the, so the added cost would be approximately $2,000, or roughly triple the cost that we now have.
Thank you. Did anybody else in the audience ask a question that has not been answered? Anybody else who spoke ask a question that we have somehow let slip through? Okay. If you have additional questions next month, we'll be glad to deal with them. Now that we have Mr. Bray.
Madam Chairman, I wonder if I can just ask a question.
If you go to the podium.
Now, please stay right there. May I ask the chairman, so this gentleman, do you have some information available?
Would you go to the podium? Come on, Mr. Adams. Oh. You know how to do this. The people at home want to hear you.
Turn up the hearing aid, ma'am. Will there be information available at the September hearing about the intersection up at Scott Dyer? Because I'm concerned about, for instance, Jonesy's gas station. Because you that's got to be addressed, and that's a serious vehicle entrance and exit right there. And the same way across the street with Balfour's. And I really think that that has really got to be looked at before anybody makes any decision about traffic lights. Because it could hinder his business terribly.
Yeah,
and it's just been redesigned.
That's right. The Maine Department of Transportation has not yet designed the particulars of the intersection. In one respect, that leaves the town in a much stronger position to negotiate with them what should happen should the council decide to go ahead with this. Even Lee Chase is here, but I think it's safe to say with state government at this point that I wouldn't predict getting answers in a one-month period.
It may take as long as to get the million-dollar bridge design.
Let's hope.
Now, the man who's would be chiefly responsible for the design is in Guatemala this week, and I don't know how long he's going to be down there. So it might. I wouldn't want to give the assurance that it might be done next month.
Thank you for your question, Mr. Adams. Are there any other questions that were brought up during the public hearing from the audience that you do not feel that we have answered this evening? Okay. Thank you. My fellow councilors, we do have Mr. Bray available, we have staff available, and I imagine there are some questions on this side. Councilor Jordan, thank you.
My question, I think, is more towards the manager, is there's other construction that's going to have to be done within these intersections, especially the Pond Cove intersection. When do we get the information on the cost of that?
I think the one major issue that you're speaking of is whether or not the traffic islands would be recontoured. We did discuss that. Bob Malley was there as well up when we met in Augusta. And those traffic islands are simply constructed on top of pavement. It's not gravel underneath there. It's actually pavement, and the dirt and the grass is thrown in on top of it. So it'd be extremely inexpensive to change those traffic islands. So you're basically talking the cost of cutting the curb, scooping out the material, and putting a new curb down. That's in the hundreds of dollars rather than the thousands of dollars. Did I answer your question?
I answered my question in a way that I just don't understand that in the figures of these lights, there's nothing as far as money involved on construction. Is that correct? That's going to be added to the cost that Mr. Bray had talked about.
The state initially in PACs, in the feds, set aside $25,000 for the Spurwink Avenue intersection and $30,000 for the Scott Dyer Route 77 Shore Road intersection. Our indication from the state the other day was if there was additional cost, if the town wanted bells and whistles and a real complicated system, provided it was at all reasonable, the message that the state gave was that that would be funded. But regardless, as a number of people have pointed out, taxpayers will be funding the cost of those things, federal, state, and local, in their proportionate shares.
That's all for now.
Thank you. Councilor Dalbec.
I may have misunderstood what Bill said, but I think at the beginning of his presentation, he made a comment that only the commissioner of the Department of Transportation made the final decisions on lights.
That's correct. The commissioner of Transportation makes that decision.
Where do we stand versus that? It sounds like we could do nothing, and he could come in and say, you're having them anyway.
The commissioner is, you know, very responsive to local concerns. He's a former local government person himself, and, you know, unless there's a, you know, they see a major safety problem there, the commissioner's not going to come in and say you have to have lights regardless of your feelings.
Second question, and this was brought up to me today by one of our citizens, and it's an issue that I have not had the opportunity to observe, but that individual's concern was down at the schools. And the loading of buses, the picking up of kids at the schools just down Scott Dyer Road, and the impact that a light might have on what I guess I would label as the psychology of the mothers or fathers who are picking up kids and how they behave relative to that light. Have we considered that at all?
Let me try. I don't know if I can answer your question, but let me make a stab at it. I was retained by the town to work on the recent school project involving the relocation of the kindergarten into the high school, as well as I was retained by the town to do the traffic study for the Public Works garage. One of the recommendations that I had made at that time was that the whole circulation into the middle school off of Scott Dyer Road needed to be addressed as far as the access locations and the different conflict points where parents can come in and either drop off or pick up children. In addition, there needs to be a level of improvement with the signage and so forth on Scott Dyer Road that better informs the motoring public that there is indeed a school, an active school in that general location. I guess if I can make your question into a two-part question, I would look at the traffic signal operation at an intersection hopefully as an improvement or something that would improve the conditions down there versus making those something that's worse than what they are. Hopefully people would be more alert as they pass through the intersection and maybe approaching the schools at a slower speed because of just recently coming through the intersection. Obviously, it's a study in itself to be able to conclude totally that, but that would be my opinion.
I think part of the concern was with the number of people picking up children at the school, you're going to run a big backup as a result of a stoplight up there at the corner.
Well, again, the traffic
light. Which then gets people trying to figure out ways to bypass the backup.
Well, again, the traffic lights would be based on a detection system. And those are all programmed so that the more vehicles you have, that the signal would yield to that increase in traffic. And in most cases, it would handle a considerable volume. In fact, the new equipment that's on the market today, you could even program in a school hour, if you wanted to call it that, where that we assign more time to the Scott Dyer Road approach just for 1 hour a day to handle that surge of traffic that may occur for that 1 hour alone. And then you just revert back to a normal, typical hourly flow from there on. The equipment today is you know, it's all it is a computer housed in a box out on the street.
Thank you.
Any other questions from councilors? Councilor Creelman?
Well, there are many factors that enter into the decision that we need to make at some point about these two lights, Mr. Bray. The main Department of Transportation, by definition, defines a high accident location as a place where eight or more accidents have occurred over a three-year period of time, and the critical accident rate factor is greater than 1.0. My concern is that in both of the studies that we have, with the exception of your work today. This is dated material. The PAC study on Spurwink intersection was written four years ago, and you know, the data that came into that was prior to that. The Shore Road Scott Dyer intersection data was a couple of years ago. At any point in this process of our struggle with this issue, is someone going to be able to say yes or no from the point of view that each of these intersections either satisfy today high accident index or not?
Typically, MDOT, the design division that examines these projects prior to actually implementing the improvements, actually before they even design the improvements, will go through a study process where they will look at the latest traffic accident data that's available when they perform that study, and they will also update the traffic information at the intersection. And if at that point, and although I can't recall of a case happening to me personally, but there may have been some other cases in the state, and at that point, if something changes and that those signals at that point are not warranted, then they would come back to the local community and say, at this point, the conditions do not warrant traffic signals based on, you know, this set of new and updated information. They generally go through that process before they prepare and submit construction drawings for the improvements. Does that answer the question?
Well, not exactly. I mean, my understanding is that, you know, a few years ago, Spurwink, for example, was 0.97. Close, but no cigar. What's up today? I mean, you know, where have we come from that 0.97? I mean, can we extrapolate and say, well, today it's 1.2, or is there any way that you can give us hard data for each of these intersections with regard to satisfying that definition?
It's very easy to obtain the latest accident information for the intersection. I just did not have, you know, an opportunity, or nor did the manager had asked me to make, you know, a complete restudy of what had been prepared. That information is available in Augusta. It's a, you know, basically a matter of just making a phone call, and the information can be supplied that they would give you the latest 3 years worth of data, which would be 1989, 1990, and 1991. And that data is available right now.
So then, who will do this? I mean, how can we get this information? We have our town manager take care of that, or Bill can give a call. I didn't update all the reports. I'm trying to save some costs, but you know, if you want to update it, that'd be fine.
I think that would be reasonable to have updated figures for our next meeting.
Well, thank you, Mr. Brown.
Yes, sir.
Councilor Cogshaw.
Yes, my question is more to the manager than to Mrs. Gray. And basically, just to let the public know that in our packet, we also have a report from the Chief of Police, Chief Pickering, dated the 17th, having intersection data as to accidents going back to 89 and up to 92 as of the 1st of May. So we do have some updated criteria. My other question is, if we accept this money, which has been sort of made available because we've gone through this process of applying for funds, do we have to use it for signalization? Can we use it for other type of corrective measures in these intersections, realigning or something? And I guess my big concern is with the Town Center Committee still working on their proposal that we do the usual government procedure where we start one project definition and take no part of it to do something else.
To answer your question, how the funds might otherwise be used would ultimately be up to the PAC's policy committee, the Maine Department of Transportation, and the Federal Highway Administration, whatever they now call it. The federal government changes so fast it's tough to keep track. But anyway, if my sense is, you know, if we try to use the funds within the intersection to address the issues that the original studies did, and new studies showed that certain changes would help out the situation, those entities would probably agree to moving the funds into those areas. If you wanted to move the funds to another intersection, the answer would probably be no. If you wanted to move it out to the outside the intersection's area, you know, to some other need within the community, the answer would be no, because PACS generally sets aside so much for intersection improvement, so much for roadway reconstruction, so much for overlays. So, you know, I think your question as to improvements within the intersections, yes, but all three entities would need to approve it, and it would need to be based on a new study.
My other question is just for information for the general public about how this whole thing was initiated with planning board studies and development pressures in the center and then going through the strategic studies.
Yeah, the Pond Cove study, I think, began, I don't remember the exact evolution of it, but, you know, my recollection is that the planning board kept having proposal after proposal affecting that intersection. We had a number of people, Bill had done some studies, some other consultants had done some studies, and, you know, it kept showing a deficiency at the intersection. Finally, 2 years ago, probably almost to this date, the town council was approached once the town studies were done to see if you wanted it to be considered in this biennium for possible funding. It was with a very clear understanding. I remember the council debating it and hands going up very reluctantly that they did want it considered for funding, but I had to swear on a stack of Bibles that the council was going to have a chance to vote on it again. So anyway, that's how that process evolved. The second intersection, I think, came out of some of the same discussions, and it particularly tied into the proposal for Maxwell's Farm Market. There was a study done at that point that, again, Bill did, that showed that light wasn't warranted at that time, but the planning board suggested that the intersection be continued to be looked at, because that report that Bill did back 2 or 3 years ago indicated that if there was a 3% growth rate, that a light would be warranted 5 years from that date, or in essence 2 years from now. You know, more traffic counts would need to be done, but as Bill indicated, the traffic volume coming out the side streets, you know, just on a survey today, was up 50%, and any of you that go to the Maxwell's Farm Market know that, you know, that has brought some more traffic, and, you know, Papuda Club is up and down too based on days.
I was part of that traffic study today with four cars trying to right. Spur from Ken Maxwell and trying to go in two different directions.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Pearson, are you all set for the duration here?
I'm just pausing in thought until next month's public hearing, and between now and then I'd hope that any more input, either at home or via the town manager, be made available to us and also to the citizens if they have questions as far as the documentation and data, if that be made available, also from the town planner perhaps. But otherwise, I'll save any comments until next month.
Very good. Councilor Chappell, are you all under control down there?
No, I'm all set till the September meeting. It's running about 50-50 on my chart here that I've got, so it's going to be quite a decision when we finally get to it and make one, which unfortunately this seven here have got to do. But it really is. Phone calls and people you talk with, and here tonight, no stoplights, headed a little bit heavy here tonight, but I hope that when the 14th of September gets here, that we can pack this place up there and stand up there and have it really packed, and let's find out what we really want. This has been wonderful tonight for me, and I got a lot better idea of what I'm doing just from you people. All this reading is fine, but those individual accounts are wonderful. So I just hope on September the 14th we get a packed house. You all come too.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Bray, I do have a question. Help me understand about the warrants a bit. How many warrants do you have to satisfy to warrant a traffic signal?
Actually, you only need to satisfy one. And I guess based on my experience, it would depend on which one I've satisfied would make a big difference on how I would feel on whether signals should be installed or not. Let me give you an example of that. If, for example, the conditions at the intersection satisfied the accident warrant, clearly satisfied that, where that we had a high frequency of angled collisions within an intersection, knowing that a traffic signal, you know, addresses angled collisions and most often reduces the severity of accidents within an intersection, if the conditions at that location met that particular warrant, then I would certainly lean much more heavily towards putting the signals in than if I had a location that the conditions were only satisfied during the peak hour. If 1 hour out of 24 hours the volumes at the intersection were met to warrant signals, I think, and everything else was running actually reasonably acceptable in the intersection, I think I would leave the intersection alone, because it really isn't going to be that much of an improvement for if you're only going to realize it for 1 hour a day. Does that help?
That helps. I know. You know, I had a feeling the different warrants might have different weight.
Yes, ma'am.
Or something like this prioritized. And I had another one that. Oh, we've talked about different types of accidents tonight. We've talked about the angle collisions and the rear end collisions. Which one is considered more dangerous, more hazardous?
Generally speaking, the angle collision. Now, yes, a head-on collision is or a fixed object accident can usually involve a greater severity of injury than any type of an accident, although an angle collision with one of the vehicles approaching at a high speed also can be an extremely damaging, if you will, type of an accident. A rear-end collision, there's always the freak type of an accident where you have, again, someone approaching at high speed. But a rear-end collision usually only involves property damage, not personal injury. The angle collision for the types of improvements that a signal can make are the ones that we look at and look at very carefully within an intersection. Does that?
Are you saying that angle collisions tend to be the more
much
serious?
More severe than a rear-end collision? I'm sorry, I thought
that's
I said
right,
that.
No, that's. Luckily, I knew the answer before I asked the question. Sometimes that happens. Okay. There was a question this evening if we would separate the two issues, and I certainly intend to do that next month when we have the public hearing. We'll have two separate votes on these two issues. They're going to be, I don't know if they'll be two separate items probably, but they will certainly be separated, and I think there's been good evidence of the need to do that this evening with the discussions varying between the two. Do you have anything else you'd like to leave with us for the evening?
No, I
just like to leave.
No, I didn't say that.
I thank you for your time. You've been very helpful.
You're quite welcome. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, the first item on the agenda is item 37. It is to consider public hearing comments on the proposed traffic lights and set a second public hearing for September 14th, 1992, and take any necessary action. I'd like a motion.
So moved.
Please.
So considered. So moved.